Economists have been saying that for the Philippine economy to return to pre-pandemic levels, the government must first ensure an effective coronavirus response. Former Philippine Socio-Economic Planning Secretary Ernesto Pernia agrees. In fact, he fears the economy might not fully recover until late 2022, partly due to the government's sluggish pandemic management. The number of coronavirus infections in the Philippines is among the highest in Asia, despite imposing one of the world's longest and strictest lockdowns in 2020. Let's now talk to Chris Nelson, the Executive Director of the British Chamber of Commerce of the Philippines. I'd like to start out by asking you, do foreign investors, particularly British investors, do they find investing in the Philippines as an attractive option?
Look, I think we've tried very hard to get British companies to come to the Philippines. I think the Philippines is attractive, but I honestly think we need to do more. And in that respect, it also would help us. So, for example, April, we're strong supporters of further liberalization of the economy. And in that respect, we're strong supporters of the Retail Liberalization Act, the Public Services Act, and linking to that, of course, getting Create passed. And the reason I say this is that the Philippines is in competition, obviously, with other countries in Southeast Asia. And when we promote in the UK to British companies, we want to be able to say, look, these things have been passed. The economy is opening up. I'll give you one further example. We were very strong supporters of the red tape, anti-red tape, and we promoted that extensively in the UK.
So with the CREATE bill looking like it will soon be acted into law, what excites you the most about it?
Well, I think what excites me the most is the reduction in the income tax, and particularly for small to medium-sized enterprises. And let me make my point. The Philippine economy, like the British economy, actually, is 90% of the companies are small to medium-sized enterprises, and they're the ones that need the most help. Now, the further benefits of CREATE, as discussed with Secretary Lopez, is it could bring in a further $200 billion in foreign investment and hopefully create another 1.2 million jobs. But I think it's the stimulus which we need to the small to medium-sized enterprise if they can give them that cash flow.
What about the adjustments in the incentives to make them more targeted and time-bound? Is that something that is just okay or is it good?
Yes, I think that's been a long discussion. Obviously, a lot of the chambers have been involved in those discussions because clearly you had locators if they've been there a long time. Now, in any bill, it's a compromise. And I think what they finally reached out to is fine. Let's see it get passed. But I think the key now is to then promote those benefits to British companies, because that's our desire. Our desire is to have more British companies enter the Philippine market.
Is a 25% corporate income tax rate already good enough, or is it enough to make the Philippines competitive in terms of attracting British investments?
Like, I mean, obviously at 30% is the current corporate rate. I believe for small enterprises who make 5 million and less, there will be 20%.
Yeah.
Obviously it's not as low as places like Singapore, but it's obviously a good step forward. I think you have to combine this with other factors. How do we promote the Philippines to British investors? First and foremost, actually, is the talent. The number one selling point of the Philippines actually is the talent of the people, you know, highly educated, English speaking. So that's a number one plus. The market itself. So I think, you know, we'll create alone won't solve the issue. It's a combination. But if we can put it correctly, yes, you can get investors and you can get people to do more business.
What about the high number of infections and the strict COVID-19, you know, restrictions in the Philippines? Is that hurting investor sentiment, or is that something that you feel is a passing issue and, you know, would not be, you know, a long-term issue?
I think obviously we're moving into the next phase. Clearly, the restrictions of ECQ, which was in March to May, really impacted the economy. I mean, the Philippine economy is down for the year 9.5%. I, along with the chambers, we support also Department of Trade and Investment. We also support NADA. NADA, I think, is now calling for the country to go to modified community quarantine. And let me quote something. I mean, we actually have, I've done a lot of work with Secretary Lopez, and he said, health and health of the economy should go together. So yes, I think restrictions are important, and it's important for our major companies to be able to start growing again. Key partners in the chamber actually need those restrictions to be eased, in conjunction, of course, working with the safety protocols.
So what other measures need to be passed for the Philippines to attract more investors, if you had the wish list?
Passing, I have to stress again, those economic liberalization acts. We want the Philippines to be not just a gateway for British companies to come to the Philippines, but a gateway to Southeast Asia. So let me stress again, Retail Liberalization Act, Public Services Act, opening up the economy. I think the other wish list, which is critical for the Philippines, is a stimulus bill. I know that Lord Velasco, the Speaker of the House, is looking at $420 billion. We did work with the Arise authors, Congress Lady Sharon Garing, and that was $1.3 trillion. I think there is a need to support the economy now. And if you look across, and obviously we draw examples from the UK, there they're extending the furlough, furlough being your paying workers, the support given in Europe, in the US. So we think combination, number one, create is a good move. Obviously, let's see it signed. Number two, retail liberalization and public services. And a further stimulus bill is very important, particularly to support small to medium-sized enterprises.
What about concerns on the government budget and the potential increase in the debt to GDP or deficit to GDP? Doesn't it matter, or, you know, it's okay at least in the short term?
I think, look, as I was a concern, and I understand where Secretary Dominguez comes from, but if you look across the world and draw examples, April, the US is very heavily, and they're looking to pass $1.3 trillion. The UK's GDP debt is at the highest levels probably since World War II, and the same for the European Union. We need to spend now in these countries because obviously we need to revive the economies. We need to get it moving because COVID has had a very severe impact. So I think stimulus is the key today. And obviously, if you get economic growth, it will pare down that debt eventually. But we need to act in now in the short term.
So with that, I'd like to thank you for your thoughts and good luck in attracting more British investments into the Philippines.